lords, ladies and gentlefolk, you are hereby cordially invited to join us in the story of Queen, the greatest rock band ever.
Queen hold a really special place in British culture because they are all things to all people.
It's the story of every sequin, every party, every stadium sing-along.
All we hear is Radio Gaga.
Every record they said would never sell.
I didn't like it. Keep yourself alive. You have an awful record.
It's how a group of misfits went from obscurity to running up some of the biggest party bills in rock history.
Anything you wanted there was there if you wanted it.
How they soaked up a set of quintessentially British influences, from baroque to rock and roll, from nights at the opera to Saturdays on the terraces.
The clap, the stamp, it's fantastic.
From innovation to eccentricity, from majesty to tomfoolery. It's a story that winds from the streets of suburbia to the biggest stages of the world. Get ready to be rocked. Get ready to be rolled. Get ready for the most fabulous musical story ever told. Queen! The story so far. After student days spent honing their individual talents, Roger, Brian, John and Freddie eventually come together to form a fledgling Queen.
Brian and Roger ended up storming the stage, and that was actually the birth of Queen.
A killer single shoots to number two and launches them into the stratosphere.
We'll be pulling blasts of vocals that you wouldn't believe belong in this genre out of nowhere just because we can.
Then one even more outrageous song, Bohemian Rhapsody, transforms their fortunes forever.
Imagine the band pitching Bohemian Rhapsody to their record company.
It's either a totally career-defining record or it's a career-ending record.
In this episode, despite a string of clap-along, stadium-sized hits, Queen managed to alienate some audiences with a cross-dressing video.
That was the beginning of the end for the band in America.
With songs like Body Language, a musical and stylistic departure that put Queen at odds with the rock world and even their own fans.
I mean, it was a shocker at the time. Everyone went, what is this?
Then there was the unique opportunity of Live Aid, which Queen rehearsed for meticulously.
They honed that set down. They just carved it like a fine diamond.
Re-energized by their Live Aid performance, Queen embark on their biggest ever tour. But little do they know at the time that it will be their last. But we begin in New York, 1979. After years of economic decline, the city is one of the most dangerous in the world. The murder rate is spiraling. The cops don't patrol some of the streets anymore, and the rich have fled to the suburbs. But away from the rubble in the underground nightclubs, a glorious sound has been thriving. Disco, which would give Queen a breakthrough.
Disco is massive and is political and is taking over space, thinking about race, thinking about sexuality. It's a really exciting, hedonistic, up all night, probably for days on end, anything goes kind of vibe.
Disco has already been big and it's practically infusing everything. And rock has had to go funky or it doesn't count anymore. And there is Queen, and Queen is still kind of Queen.
Queen are in New York promoting their album Jazz, but the American critics aren't loving it. The band know they need to reinvent themselves. So one member set off through the gritty streets of New York for inspiration.
John Deacon was the Motown fan in the group and the disco fan, quietly listening away to his Nile Rodgers records.
And he really loved this very R&B, sort of beat-driven style. Just the kind of thing that turned John Deacon on.
Songs like Le Freak, performed here, were the toast of the New York club scene, not least because of fellow bass player Bernard Edwards's driving, danceable bass lines. After an evening delving into Manhattan's nightlife, John dropped in on Chic's recording studio.
Just picture this. Chic are hanging out and John Deacon is there. And they're hanging out together.
And he had a conversation with Chic.
I don't know if they regret this now, but yeah, they pushed play. Here's what we've been working on.
The song they played was Good Times, driven by another catchy bass line from Bernard Edwards, seen here with the rest of the band on The Tonight Show. The bass line gave John an idea.
Chic. Queen.
Beginning with this unmistakable bass line, John was inspired by Chic to write Another One Bites the Dust, performed here for their promo, which initially sounds similar to Good Times.
Now, Good Times goes bum, 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 then it goes bum, ba dum, bum, 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 ba dum, bum, bum. Another One Bites the Dust goes bum, 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 same three notes, then it goes ba dum, bum, bum, ba dum.
When you hear the opening of Another One Bites the Dust, it's not evident at all that it's a Queen song. So it's almost a shock to the system to hear Freddie coming in.
But Freddie's singing gave the disco bassline that kind of magic that only Queen could add to the genre, making the song as a whole unmistakably their own.
This is a really good example of him being much more percussive with how he's singing. So he's actually, he's singing as a form of rhythm.
So he is absolutely spitting out those lyrics, like bullets, the bullets that kill the person so they bite the dust.
Every word is on the rhythm, and that is what really gives it the energy.
There's a force there, there's pumping, and then it just explodes.
Queen had recorded this disco-influenced tune for their new album, The Game, but weren't sure about putting it out as a single until a friend suggested they should release it.
Michael Jackson heard the song and was hanging out with the band and said, "You need something for the cats to dance to." And he said, "You should release this as a single."
Michael Jackson also may have had a role in the sound of the song.
That Another One Bites the Dust in the middle is pure Freddie Mercury does Michael Jackson. All right? Even the pronunciation of it, Another One Bites the Dust. 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 It's pure Michael.
This bassline-driven, disco-esque tune was a worldwide hit, and not just for traditional Queen fans.
Brian May had mentioned that this was a really important moment for Queen because it was the first crossover in the black music scene for them.
They had already locked up their rock fans, but they didn't necessarily have a following with the black music audience, and this changed everything.
This was mega. I mean, this was a song that was in the American charts for over half a year, and it was a huge R&B hit. It was incredible.
Whilst John was changing Queen's sound, Freddie was inspired by the New York club scene to change his look. Out partying one night with friend and famous rock photographer Mick Rock, Freddie spotted someone across the dance floor.
Mick Rock escorted Freddie to a notorious club called the Anvil, and Freddie met for the first time Glenn Hughes, the sort of leather-clad biker chap in The Village People, and was blown away.
The heavy biker guy, head-to-toe black leather, the chains, the bare chest, the cap, and mustache. And Freddie clocked it, and he saw his future. He thought, yeah, that's how I want to look. Freddie's look in the 70s. It was all about head-to-toe unitard or satin capes. But after he had his epiphany, he was actually much more macho, you know, of the jeans and the black leather, you know, very pared back, quite athletic, quite masculine.
The Village People's look was a gay clone look. So that look that Freddie Mercury adopted was very much a reflection of the look he found attractive in men. He had a bit of a thing for Burt Reynolds, by all accounts, and he went for it full on.
Coming up, Freddie's love of nightlife takes the band from New York to another disco city, Munich.
Freddie threw himself right in to Munich's hedonistic lifestyle.
Everything was through a haze of vodka.
And after creating Elvis-inspired crazy little thing called Love, Queen go back to Switzerland for a duet with Bowie on Under Pressure, which you can see Freddie performing here in Montreal.
He's just swooping and doing falsetto stuff.
Sorry.
That's unique.
Embarrassing. I'm heading back on New Year's Eve for a party. You should come.
Myself?
Take my number.
News of a £15 million lottery ticket still unclaimed.
Bravo, guy! You won.
Right, dinner's on. Ready for the father and son dream team?
Sizzling, roasting.
Peanuts?
Scorched, steaming.
Mum's roly-poly.
Burning, dangerous.
Annoying the ref.
Hot.
Fire. It's fire. Championi! Shame about the big chicken.
You mean turkey?
See, son, that's how it's done.
Articulate, the fast-talking description game. Just remember, it's only a game.
Yeah, that's what losers say.
Peggy 18.
There was an outbreak. They killed everyone.
You do what you've got to do in here. This place is a way of changing you.
These aren't accidents. They're all connected somehow.
Hello, my friend. Life comes at you fast, so make time for you time, with Just Eat. Get all of the food for all of the times. Christmas cheer times, reindeer times, don't even know what day it is times. The perfect times for the McDonald's bacon roll, Pizza Express American hot, Five Guys cheeseburger and strawberry shake, Greg's steak bake, Costa coffee latte and KFC bargain bucket. So order now, later, whenever. Christmas, we got it.
Did somebody say Just Eat?
Paramount, streaming the stars and causing a
buzz. There's so many stars.
Original series, there's plenty to see. Top the Maverick will fill you with glee. Paramount Plus, mountain of entertainment for us. Oh. 'Tis the season for streaming, so don't delay your mountain holiday.
Paramount Plus, a mountain of blockbuster entertainment.
Since the mid-1970s, many of Britain's best musicians have been spending increasing amounts of time abroad. Queen's huge success saw them follow the trend and move to Europe.
They'd gone to Munich with no pressure. We could come and go, and we lived in the Munich Hilton. I mean, I think I spent over a year of my life in the Munich Hilton. Because the band liked Munich, they said, let's book the studio and sort of throw some ideas down. It worked so well those first 6 weeks where Crazy Little Thing came out of it.
The freedom of being away from Britain and the British press inspired Queen to yet again break the rock rules. With Crazy Little Thing Called Love, they had fun with a trend the music press thought was cheesy, but the public loved. The rockabilly revival, where 70s teenagers harked back to 50s rock and roll.
Rockabilly's really big. Shaking Stevens is having number one after number one. The Stray Cats are really big. Queen release, Crazy Little Thing Called Love.
It's immediately evident, both from the song and its accompanying video, how much of an homage Queen are paying to Elvis, the king of rock and roll.
It's a great rockabilly record, but it's got all the Queen hallmarks.
Freddie's vocal, he's doing this kind of Elvis croon, like it's quite dulcet and soft for him. And it's just really nice to hear him playing around in that range.
Freddie had always been a big fan of Elvis Presley, and he wrote Crazy Little Thing Called Love really as a tribute to Elvis.
It was just his chance to kick up his heels and pay homage to rock and roll history.
And of course, this created a turning point yet again in America, because America's long been in love with Elvis, and they presented this on a plate, really. This was a song he came up with. Some say in about 10 minutes, some people say it took him a couple of hours, but he really had the whole thing mapped out. This was Freddie when he sat down to write a song. He didn't mess about. It usually did just pour out of him, came off the top of his head. And it was a real Elvis tribute. And I'm not sure the others particularly liked it to begin with, but they were always intelligent enough to be diplomatic. You know, when you've got four songwriters in a band, and in this particular band, four people capable of writing number one hits, and they all did several times. So there's always going to be songs that not all of them are in love with, and they're all going to be pushing their own songs. This was not one, I think, that they were all crazy about, but Crazy Little Thing Called Love did them a huge favour.
Crazy Little Thing Called Love took a long ride on its motorbike all the way up the charts to number one in the US and helped send the Game album to the top of the album charts in both the US and the UK. After such success recording away from Britain, Queen extended their trip and stayed in Europe a little longer to start their next album, Hot Space, this time in Switzerland.
They at this point had acquired their own recording studio in Montreux in Switzerland, Mountain Studios, and they're recording all their albums there.
Not only was it state of the art, but it was on a beauty spot, Lake Geneva, just the epitome of luxury.
Switzerland was home to another A-lister who dropped into Queen's studio one evening to join a jamming session. Enter David Bowie.
David lived just down the road. I think the word got around that Queen are here, so David came in, and it was like, oh, well, how are you? Great, great, you know. Love you, you know. And they actually just started jamming.
The idea was he was going to contribute some backing vocals to Cool Cat. And he said, look, this is silly. Let's grab this opportunity and do something with it.
Under Pressure was totally unexpected. It was certainly not planned.
It's like superheroes getting together. And, you know, my God, they did not disappoint.
Beginning with John Deacon's unmistakable bass intro, the song from that late-night jam session was Under Pressure, which Queen performed here without Bowie, live in Montreal in 1981.
John Deacon doesn't get enough credit. That is one of the great iconic bass lines of pop music.
It feels friendly and inviting and kind of open arms.
After John Deacon found the bass line, Bowie and Freddie then started putting in the vocals, ad-libbing at first, then coming in unison for the first verse.
Words ad-libbed in the studio, and you've got the beautiful way in which their voices dovetail. Bowie's very deep. I don't know what he is. I guess he's just a tenor, but, you know, Freddie's singing extremely high on that record.
These are the days
It's just so easy. He's not blasting through. He's not having to push. He's not competing with David Bowie. Just swooping and doing falsetto stuff.
Just this totally friendly flamboyance that I think Bowie and Freddie Mercury and Queen really embodied so well.
One of those magical things in time, you know, and just came together. It was interesting with Fred and with Bowie, because both of them, you could say that they had an ego, but actually Fred's ego is over-exaggerated. He was very, very modest in private, very quiet, unassuming. He was two people. And he was the Freddie Mercury you see giving it all this. And he was the Freddie Mercury who's at home playing Scrabble and desperate to get the seven-letter word.
But this collaboration perhaps wasn't as magical for every member of the band.
Brian May was rather miffed at how this recording was proceeding. And they didn't record the entire thing in Mountain Studios. It was taken off to New York for various reasons and completed there, at which point Brian stepped back because he was a bit annoyed that he didn't have control. But with two gigantic personalities like Freddie and David Bowie in the mix, you know, there wasn't room for another kind of big head in that. So Brian took a back seat.
I think it affected Brian most of all, I think, because Brian, again, technically, he likes to have his fingers on everything and to know exactly what's going on. And to have someone else in the control room twisting the knobs and doing, and no, I think this failure should be, in the end, I think he sort of pulled back a bit.
Under Pressure got Queen their second number one in the UK, the first being Bohemian Rhapsody. And this single was the only time Queen recorded a song with another artist. Or was it? Peter Hintz remembers more tracks from that session.
And they played all the Young Dudes. They did All Right Now by Free, did all this stuff. And it did all go down on tape, whether it's lost forever or it's in some James Bond bunker in Switzerland.
The idea that there could be more Queen-Bowie collaborations in a secret vault somewhere, I mean, it's just totally exciting.
Who knows if us Queen fans will ever get to discover these unheard gems?
Possibly.
Switzerland had become home and offered a great environment to record in. Meanwhile, over the border, their old stomping ground of Munich is quietly becoming one of the most influential party cities in the world. So they hopped over to Musicland Studios to continue work on their as yet unfinished album, Hot Space. That is, when they weren't preoccupied with extracurricular activities.
The thing to say about Munich is that he got more and more shattered, trashed. What other word do you use? Plastered.
Munich. Now that's a city. It had a very strange effect on all of them. Because at that time, West Germany was a lot freer socially than Britain even was at that time. And so you could get up to anything and everything there. With all the leather bars that were there, everything. Everything was sort of excessive. There was this one bar that was known all over the world, even made into a Queen song, was the Sugar Shack. Every musician who was ever in Munich always ended up in that bar. Anything and everything was available in that bar. The thing is, Queen were never stupid. They never once said, okay, recording starts at 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock in the morning. A Queen recording day always started at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. Two reasons. One, most people were only getting up at midday because they'd been out until 4 or 5 in the morning. But also, your fingers aren't loose. the voice isn't able to record well at 9 o'clock in the morning.
It was an opportunity for Freddie to go completely wild.
Munich had become the epicenter for disco and electronic music. Musicland Studios had a special disco heritage. It was owned by Giorgio Moroder, who'd recorded the disco hit I Feel Love with Donna Summer, as seen here, with its mesmeric vocal and pulsating synthesizer bass line, typifying the electronic disco sound of the times. Looking for inspiration, Queen were drawn like moths to a flame. This electronic disco sound infused the city and its swathe of late-night clubs.
We went to a club called the Sugar Shack, and it is the best nightclub. It stayed open till 4 in the morning, and then we would go out to the market that was opening up and go to a cafe and a champagne, and then back to the hotel, usually back to Fred's suite, and we would party. And we didn't get up till about 2 in the afternoon, you know, and... Yeah, I mean, it was great.
Recording would start at 2 o'clock. For Freddie particularly, if things were feeling good, he could actually then stay in the studio till 6 o'clock in the morning. But quite often, things would be really hard work, and 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock, he'd be out. Off he'd go into the bars with friends. And he would just, that would be it until 4 o'clock in the morning. He would just be out drinking with people. Munich has a way of sapping your willpower. You might have very, very good intentions during the day, but once you're there, there's something that, I don't know what it is about the city, but there's something about the city that just takes you out. It takes you into the world of drink.
Freddie was still friends with Mary Austin, his long-term girlfriend from the 70s, but he was now having a whale of a time exploring his sexuality.
His personal life was very tangled at this point. He has entangled himself with a man called Winnie Kirschberger, a restaurateur in Munich. On top of that, he fell for a woman called Barbara Valentin, an Austrian soft porn actress. So he has a triangle going on. There are lots of people vying for his attention. I think Freddie rather loved this.
The band's excessive partying sent the recording of their album, Hot Space, a little off track.
Brian May said when I interviewed him once, his memories of recording Hot Space and working in Munich was everything through a haze of vodka. Brian May remembers being up half the night trying to record guitar solos. Everything got blurred.
And in the end, I think it showed them the dangerous side of what it could do to a group even as close as Queen.
After a year in the making, Queen released their 10th album, Hot Space, on the 21st of May, 1982. The first single from it was Under Pressure, which had gone down a storm, so expectations were high. But on release, the album Hot Space and its next single, Body Language, didn't receive the warmest welcome from their fans. According to Queen folklore, it was considered by many to be commercial suicide.
It's considered, in hindsight, to have been a flop. It did actually get to number 4 in the UK, so I wouldn't consider that a flop. But the fans largely didn't go for it because it seemed to be a departure from the Queen sound.
Single Body Language, with this racy promo video, is a good example of Queen's shift over to dance and funk on Hot Space that perhaps went a bit too far, both visually and musically. I got a case of body
language. The song Body Language is kind of weird because it's almost like swing jazz vocal group type thing, because like tight harmonies and it's, you know, finger snaps, and so it seems a little jazzy. And then you contrast that with the video, which is just a tangle of bodies filmed very close up, so you don't really know which kibbles and bits you're deep diving into.
I mean, it was a shocker at the time. Everyone went, what is this? It's ambition, it's experimentation. They wanted to try and do something different. They never wanted to be predictable.
Just like the single, the album got a mixed response. But so what? Queen had often had bad reviews, but always huge record sales.
Freddie just said, it's music. If you don't like it, you don't like it. This is what we have done.
At the start of 1983, after months of excess and a muted reaction to their latest album, the boys decided to have a break and take a year off.
They had been rather disappointed, I think, by the reaction to Hot Space. They'd had time off in 1983 to consider their futures. They ordered solo projects. They were not particularly happy. They were sort of on the verge of breaking up at certain points.
Brian did his Starfleet project with this unique video.
Starfleet, cute. I mean, there's Brian. He wants to make a project that his young son is going to be impressed by. It's for Japanese kids television, but my goodness, it is so nerdy. This is one for fans only.
Brian was working with Eddie Van Halen and various other people. Roger was making his own albums.
Songs such as Man on Fire see Roger no longer behind the drum kit, but instead fronting this Bruce Springsteen-esque single in terms of both music and image.
They'd been together by this time for nearly 13 years, and very few bands last that long. You know, the Beatles only lasted 7 years. It's hard to equate that, isn't it, now? But it would be quite natural if they'd decided to call it a day at that point.
Coming up, just when it looks like they've lost their way, Queen get back on track with their epic hit, Radio Gaga.
The classic Queen ability to sort of harness the power of the football crowd.
A Corrie-themed video makes I Want to Break Free a hit in the UK, but not in the US.
America would not support I Want to Break Free.
This is MTV Generation Change and the Open University's Ones to Watch. Meet Leander, an OU graduate and founder of Amphrovision, championing positive well-being in her community.
I needed to be able to educate myself to start up my business. Open University degrees are world recognised and essentially gave me the skills that I need now. Open University built my confidence a lot and it feels like one big supportive community.
Whatever your passion, whatever the circumstances, the future is open with the Open University.
Introducing our new Ben & Jerry's sundaes and their creamy whipped ice cream topping and chunks and swirls and fair trade ingredients and 4 great new flavors, and we're out of time.
Sorry.
That's unique.
Embarrassing. Oh, I'm heading back on New Year's Eve for a party. You should come.
Myself?
Oh, take my number.
News of a £15 million lottery ticket still unclaimed.
Bravo, guy! You won.
On the last day of Christmas, my true love gave to me supercar experience, fine dining, dinner, wine, water rafting tour, Wembley Stadium, near cat encounter, chill, couple spa day, hot air balloon ride, champagne afternoon tea, glamping weekend view from the shard, cooking masterclass, and cocktails made for two.
Best gifts ever. Search Virgin Experience Days to find their perfect gift this Christmas.
Stuff dreams are made of.
We sold $575 million last year alone.
And our nightmares.
You've been evicted?
Yeah, we're being evicted.
I'm Brian Cox. I want to find out what money does to you, to me, how it affects all our lives, and why the world is becoming so divided between the haves and the have-nots.
Honestly, we live week to week now.
It's extremely painful, this stuff.
It was just short of 90 million to buy.
Do you think that you could be fueling an obsession with wealth?
Look, look, rats. Loads of rats.
After my father died, we were left destitute. Money is very much my own personal demon, something that I've avoided confronting until now.
Brian Cox, How the Other Half Live. Watch now on MyFive.
Queen took a break in 1983, which allowed individual members to focus on solo projects. As a result, rumours abounded that the band would split.
I don't think breaking up really was in anybody's mind. They just needed a break. If you look, 1983, they had been working basically non-stop for 12, 13 years. And at the start, they'd been working whenever they could, evenings, nights, everything to get recording done, all of that sort of thing. So they were tired. They also did want to discover what they could do, because all four of them were musicians. All four of them created the music. So after, I think, Hot Space, they decided that maybe it's time that, you know, particularly Brian and Roger, that they did their own stuff just to see what direction that would take them. The thing that always happens, though, I mean, and this happened with the band, it just took a couple of years. They always found, when they were doing their solo projects, that they missed each other.
So whether it was because they missed each other, or whether it was due to rumours of a split, or maybe even because of the poor critical reception of Hot Space, Queen decided to show the critics what's what.
Because of all the criticism, Roger turned around and said, well, OK, if that's what they're saying, let's give them the works.
The works was really an attempt to get back in with the public, back in with the critics, and have a run of hit singles and do what they did best.
It was back to being Queen again, with a bit more rock and roll.
So Queen returned to their rock and roll roots, but thanks to their time spent in Munich soaking up the electro sounds, they added a 1980s twist.
They needed to do something different, and so they incorporated synthesizers.
On their early albums, they used to put, no synthesizers were used in the making of this album. It was one of their big boasts.
Cleverly, instead of just going along with synthesizers grudgingly, how about making the most of it? Making the synthesizer the star of the record.
This was a big turning point for Queen. They brought in a sort of unofficial fifth member, Fred Mandell, who was the synth guru.
They pretty much exploited what they could of the guitar world, you know, and started trying out new things in the synthesizer world, that they went from this huge guitar assault to this, you know, much smaller but powerful rhythmic thing. And I think they were trying to explore the modern world, which was synths in the 80s.
Their first single to truly forefront the synthesizer sound would become an all-time classic.
The very opening of Radio Gaga, you're hearing this percolating, bubbly electronic noise, and then it goes into this drony, inviting wash of synths, and you know that they have officially entered the brave new world.
But it wasn't their new synth guru who led them into their brave new world. It was actually their own rock-loving drummer.
It was inspired by his son, who is half French, who was 2 years old and said something like, oh, radio caca. He didn't like the sound of the music on the radio. So he said this, and like all great pop songs, that nonsense phrase was thrown about a bit.
Apparently Roger Taylor came up with the idea, then didn't know what to do with it, gave it to Freddie, went on a skiing holiday, and Freddie finished it. Great. Makes you a bit annoyed being a solo artist. I wish I could just go on a skiing holiday and give an idea to someone else and come back to Radio Gaga.
The single Radio Gaga, seen here, combined an 80s synthesizer-based sound with the tried-and-tested stadium approach of their 70s hits. and was accompanied by this innovative video that also cleverly combines the old with the new.
In Radio Gaga, you can see a lot of the classic Queen ability to sort of harness the power of the football crowd. The hand clapping and the unifying motif of that chorus became so big, but it's very similar to the We Are the Champions, We Will Rock You, the first real big hits that they had.
All we hear is Radio Gaga, Radio Gaga. And everyone's got this part to play in the sound of it, again, being this fifth member of the band.
Its potential as a stadium sing-along was even evident the first time Radio Gaga was ever played to fans, at the video shoot itself.
So in November 1983, they shot the live sequences in Shepperton Studios, and they invited genuine Queen fans down to take part in the clapping sequences, which are unforgettable, aren't they? And which were replicated by an audience that wasn't a Queen audience at the Live Aid gig in Wembley in July 1985. So that was not their audience out there, but everybody knew what to do and everybody rose to the occasion. So that became an indelible part of the Queen live experience.
And luckily, Freddie's vocals made it easier for us fans to sing too.
You've had your time, and it's so soaring, like the way that vocal comes in. I mean, I'm in falsetto there, but Freddie's like open voice.
You've yet to have your finest hour. Then they got radio, and instead of taking it up, they bring it down to where we can all sing along. All we hear is suddenly it's dropped in pitch, but it hasn't dropped in intensity. This is the most intense bit. This is the sing-along bit.
By the time we get to Radio Gaga, we're in the age of MTV.
I want my MTV.
And it suddenly became about coming up with the biggest and the most spectacular videos to promote the songs, to the point that the videos became more important than the songs.
The video of Radio Gaga and its video montage was Queen's dig at the rise of MTV video culture, yet they still wanted their video to pull out all the stops in terms of their own use of the medium.
They very cleverly pulled footage from the classic black and white 20s film Metropolis, about a dystopian future, and they married it to this futuristic look where the band are leading an army of their followers in this electronic love letter to radio.
Radio Gaga got Queen back in with their fans and back into the charts, reaching number 2. It seemed all was forgiven after their not-so-popular album, Hot Space. But their follow-up single proved to be as polarizing as it was iconic. From its very opening, its video was unashamedly inspired by British culture, played through a uniquely Queen lens, once again with an eye on MTV.
John Deacon wrote, "I Want to Break Free."
In my opinion, there's very little not to love about "I Want to Break Free." It's maybe my favorite Queen song.
"I Want to Break Free" video, which was, of course, Freddie's pastiche to Coronation Street, you know, of which he was a fanatical Coronation Street fan. And any talk about characters, talk about plot lines.
"I want to break free."
It was this absolutely stunning video. Roger Taylor dressed as a schoolgirl. It's so good.
A lot of men of a certain age did find Roger Taylor attractive. There was a particular point where he's washing up at the sink, and it's only when he turns around you realise it was Roger. And I know that caused confusion for some.
That was a piece of English humour, really. You know, men dressing up as women, hilarious. For all its the gay undertones of it, it was just really funny for the public, and everybody in the UK loved that video.
Everyone loved this video, especially Freddie's outrageous performance. But everyone also loved the epic solo in the middle of the song. which was a little bit different from the usual Queen guitar solo.
Listen to that and you think it's Brian May, and it's not. It's Fred Mandel, who's a synthesizer player.
Yeah, I went into the studio with Mac and John Deacon, and they had a basic guitar track down, not much else. And then John asked me if I could do a solo. I'd been in other sessions before. It was no big deal. I didn't even think about it. Okay, I'll do a solo here. And I did it in one take. It was a very quick solo, punched in the last note, which goes down a whole octave.
But this placeholder synth solo ended up on the final single.
John Deacon said, I think I like that better. I think I really, this adds something different, because everybody would expect, like, okay, you know, Brian's back, he's great, we know, but, you know, it's always going to be in this spot. And it was actually quite inspired just to leave this placeholder in.
I didn't understand that I had replaced possibly a guitar solo on there. It didn't dawn on me at the time.
And the thing that is so crazy about this fake Brian May solo, which was on a Roland synthesizer, was that the Roland synthesizer people heard it, didn't clock that it was played on a Roland synthesizer, and thought, there's something about this that suggests it would be really great to include in one of our synthesizer sounds on the next iteration of the Roland synthesizer. They sampled it and put it on as a Brian May guitar solo. Duh.
With its hilarious but idiosyncratically British video, the song cleaned up in the pop charts of many countries and was a top 10 hit across Europe and South America. But in the USA, it was a disaster.
The video, it went down really well in the UK, because men in the UK have always dressed up as women and loved it and had a laugh. But it did not do well in the US because they didn't find it funny.
America would not support I Want to Break Free, not because of the record, but because of the video. When Ronald Reagan became president, the deregulation of American radio started. There were a couple of conglomerates that owned over 2,000, and they were homophobic. They were run by right-wing Republicans.
And so this flopped spectacularly in the States.
MTV wouldn't take it, they wouldn't show it. And so they said to the band, or the record company said, well, just do a performance video, you know, just go on stage and just go through the money. And they said, no, you can off. It's probably what Fred said.
And they were furious. They realized that they'd gone too far, but they had played that game all along. They had pushed the envelope, and the chickens had come home to roost.
After the peak of their two number ones in America, I Want to Break Free only made it to number 45. Their American dream was over.
And that was the beginning of the end for the band in America, which is, I think it's a terrible shame. I think America is big and bold and brash. And then so are Queen. And I think they kind of deserved one another. But the feeling amongst the band was, oh, don't worry, we'll go back again, dear, and just play the big places. Well, you know, America's not like that. You've got to keep at it. You've got to keep doing it.
Songs such as It's a Hard Life, with this particularly flamboyant performance from Freddie, and its trademark operatic style, helped the Works album become a hit everywhere outside America, providing Queen with some of their biggest hits of the 80s. Freddie himself has often referred to It's a Hard Life as one of his own favourite songs, a preference shared by many.
So my favourite track on the Works album was It's a Hard Life, said to be inspired by Smokey Robinson's Tears of a Clown. And this was Freddie back being Scaramouche again, being the life and soul of the party, the clown entertaining everybody and got the world in the palm of his hand. But inside he's hurting, and he's hurting because he's not able to be himself. So Freddie's old dysfunctions and troubles are starting to bubble under the surface again, and he's expressing them in his songs.
Giving the audience the Works had taken its toll on the band.
By the end of that period and the tour that followed the Works album, the band were not in the best state. They were getting on each other's nerves a little bit. Roger had done solo projects, Brian had done one. Freddie was about to do his own. And I think they kind of felt, well, where can we go from here?
Queen were at the tail end of their tour for The Works when they were invited to play Sun City, a glitzy venue in a rural area of South Africa.
Sun City was an upscale Vegas-style entertainment resort in South Africa, and loads of international bands played there. I mean, Rod Stewart, Elton John, Dolly Parton. But the UN had imposed a cultural boycott against musicians and acts touring South Africa because of apartheid.
There was pretty widespread agreement within the music industry that what was happening in South Africa was abhorrent, and music and popular culture could be used to challenge apartheid, and secondly, that musicians should not profit from apartheid.
Despite the boycott, Queen decided to play Sun City anyway.
There were some performers said, don't tell us we can't go. We'll go and make up our own minds when we see it. Well, they did go and they made up their own minds. Unfortunately, it was, boy, this sucks.
Buenas noches.
Queen had played politically charged destinations before. In 1981, they performed live in Argentina, then under the military regime of Roberto Viola, a choice which critics later questioned. But in South Africa, playing somewhere controversial backfired instantly.
They had been told, or claimed they'd been told, they would be playing to mixed audiences. That actually wasn't true at all. And I know Roger really regrets going and says it was a bad decision.
And they were castigated to the nth degree for having done this.
As Daryl Hall from Hall & Oates makes plain in this interview.
Rod Stewart and Queen and people like that have played there are jerks for doing it. And they were more than aware of what they were doing. And I think that they should be called out for it.
It seemed to sum up everything that the critics didn't like about them already, which was arrogance, superiority, and I suppose a certain head-in-the-sand attitude towards political events that were going on in the world. Queen have never been forgiven for playing Sun City.
Coming up, Queen are left off the list for Band Aid.
Queen were not invited to take part in the Band Aid recording, and they were miffed.
But they get a chance at a comeback in Live Aid, performing this set, including Bohemian Rhapsody, amongst other greatest hits.
Believe it or not, the furry family felines that enrich our lives today really aren't so very different from the African wildcats they're descended from. So the more we know about their wild ancestry, the better equipped we'll be to keep our feline family members happy. You can learn more about your cat's wild side by requesting this free guide, packed with tips on how to recognize and manage natural cat behaviors. So whether you've got a tiny tiger or the king of the jungle, text Guide 5 to 70007 or search Cats Protection Behavior to get your copy today.
Times are tight. And right now, things can feel a little constrained. Like there isn't much wiggle room. Sure, you can get a new phone if you want, but is that always right for you?
With EE, you can get an annual checkup on your current device designed to keep your phone in tip-top condition. Count on EE, the UK's best network.
This is MTV Generation Change and the Open University's Ones to Watch. Meet Carly, who is using her OU degree to champion a more environmentally friendly lifestyle through her plant-based company, The Random Vegans.
My OU course has helped me build my brand from the ground up. My tutors are always so supportive and really helped me through my studies. Although it's distance learning, you're never alone. The OU has given me the skills and confidence to start my own business.
Whatever your passions, whatever the circumstances, the future is open with the Open University.
Introducing our new Ben & Jerry's sundaes and their creamy whipped ice cream topping and chunks and swirls and fair trade ingredients and four great new flavors, and we're out of time.
Irresistibly smooth, melting Lindor. This Christmas, you choose the moment. We'll provide the bliss. from the Lindt Master Chocolatier.
Welcome to Pluto TV, a free streaming service. Over 150 live channels, from crime to movies Action. To reality, and a whole lot more.
Here I am.
No sign up, so you can dive right in.
Yes, babe.
Drop in. It's free. Pluto TV.
In November 1984, Queen had returned from their Sun City gigs in South Africa to find they'd received a kicking in the music press and a musicians' union fine. Weeks later, they received yet another blow. Bob Geldof was gathering up rock and pop stars to perform on his charity single, Band Aid. But Queen weren't on the list.
Queen were not invited to take part in the Band Aid recording, and they were miffed. There is a suggestion that they were passed over quietly for the Feed the World Band-Aid single because of the Sun City performance and all the controversy that it created. I have heard that they were rather upset to have been ignored for that. Once again, their star was in The Descendant, and I think a lot of people did think at that time that Queen would call it a day.
The Band-Aid single raised $8 million to help the victims of Ethiopia's famine. But 6 months later, news reports showed that the country was still reeling from the catastrophe. Now Bob wanted to do more.
How many times must you see a child die in your living room before you just say enough?
Bob Geldof wanted to stage the biggest concert the world had ever known, broadcast to 150 countries. And thanks to the technology of the time, his impossible dream was made possible.
We might imagine that the big charity concert kind of begins with Band-Aid, but actually it does go back further. So George Harrison's concert for Bangladesh or Amnesty International's Secret Policeman's Ball already kind of had the formula in place. But I think what's different about Live Aid is the scale of it and that it coincides with this globalisation, the ability to have broadcast in the States and in Britain, facilitated by Concord.
To create this mega concert, Bob Geldof also needed the biggest and best bands on board. And this time, Queen were invited to play. They rehearsed their set for Live Aid meticulously, realising that it could be their chance to shake off the last few months of turmoil and get back on top.
When Queen were invited to be a part of Live Aid, there was a lot at stake. I mean, they were already considered on the naughty step after performing in South Africa. This was their chance to remind everyone how fantastic they were. So they booked a rehearsal space, made every minute of their allotted time count.
Queen rehearsed so hard for their slot in Live Aid. They rehearsed and they rehearsed and they rehearsed till they got it timed absolutely perfectly.
I went out and bought these clocks, these big white plastic clocks, battery clocks, and I put them at the front of the stage. So when they went through the set, they could see how long it was going to be.
I didn't hear of any other artist who'd actually rehearsed to play at Live Aid. Most of them just sort of rambled on stage with their guitars across the car park and just got up there and did a couple of numbers and got off. Queen had meetings about it, as they would, because they did everything over the top and never by halves.
They honed that set down. They just carved it like a fine diamond.
By rehearsing so hard and so intensely, it was nailed the minute they put their foot on that stage.
And this electric performance at Live Aid was to relaunch Queen's career just at a time when they needed it most.
The BBC listeners and viewers, when polled who was the best at Live Aid, 60% said Queen. Now, you can't get 50% of people to agree when to get up in the morning. To actually all agree that Queen stole the show means they stole the show.
I think it had a huge effect on the band. They were galvanized by it.
And suddenly, I think maybe for the first time ever, with a universal acceptance that Queen were an entity on their own. They weren't a category. They were Queen.
But whilst soaking up the adulation of the Live Aid crowd, Freddie was now leading a double life as both the lead singer of Queen and also as a solo artist. An amazing feeling comes. And through songs such as I Was Born to Love You, we can see Freddie starting to reveal himself in a more personal way. The we of We Will Rock You has become the I of I Was Born to Love You.
We all knew that Freddie was gay by this time, but we weren't writing about it. We weren't taking pictures and exposing his behavior or anything like this. Everybody knew. Who cared?
Holly Johnson was out. Jimmy Somerville was out. But for Freddie, it was more complicated because he had been established for a decade and a half, and they had followers all over the world in countries and cultures that were not accepting of a man loving another man.
He came from a very religious family. The record companies did not want him to come out because they thought, naively, that this would put girls off buying the records.
The video to Living on My Own is very much a celebration of Freddie's beloved 1980s Munich scene, which is also reflected in the club-friendly music production. The real joy in the video is because the party is real and features many of his own friends and acquaintances, who are clearly enjoying themselves as much as Freddie is, providing something of a counterpoint to the loneliness of the lyric.
Freddie Mercury turned 39 in 1985 after Live Aid, and he threw a party at Henderson's, the gay nightclub in Munich. It was known as the Black and White Ball.
The invitation specifies that they must come dressed in black and white.
They filmed the video for Living on My Own there, which then, I believe, the cost of the party could be deducted against tax, which was very clever.
Freddie hired a jet, and we all met at Heathrow, and flew us to Munich, 100 of us.
It was, as you would imagine, riotous. There were a lot of very gay men there, a lot of facial hair and tight leather trousers, some without any trousers, and a feather coming out the back. Let's not go there.
And then the champagne flowed. Anything you wanted there was there if you wanted it.
It's a peephole into his social life. It's full of beautiful, amazing drag queens, wild decadence. Everyone's poured over each other. Everyone's kind of licking each other and grabbing each other's legs and all that kind of thing. And then the other members of Queen were actually at that party as well. Brian May was dressed as a witch. Roger Taylor was dressed as a schoolgirl.
The party started at 10 o'clock at night and went on beyond 4 or 5 o'clock the next morning. This was hedonism on a grand scale.
This was somebody who, because of the way things were then, was not allowed to be openly gay in interviews. He wasn't allowed to talk about his boyfriends. It wasn't done. And then it was saying, well, look, this is who I am. And it can't get more blatant, really.
In addition to Freddie's solo career blossoming, Queen, the band, also wanted to capitalise on their Live Aid success. One Vision, beginning with Brian's searing guitar intro, was the first hit to follow Live Aid in November 1985.
After Live Aid, I think the band thought, hey, you know, we're still really good at this. There is this magic that brought us together, that kept us together, brought all that success. It's still there. And out of that came the magic album.
Catapulting immediately to number one in the UK, this album was a hit, selling 100,000 copies in its first week alone, and launching Queen off onto the most successful tour of their entire career. Coming up, the magic tour takes Queen to dizzying new heights.
It's taken days to transform Wembley Stadium into a venue fit for the Queen.
But none of them knew that this would be the last tour they would ever take together.
Irresistibly smooth, melting Lindor. This Christmas, you choose the moment. We'll provide the bliss.
Thank you.
from the Lindt Master Chocolatier.
For Daisy at number 12, because she sparkles like a disco. For Uncle Bob and his sweet tooth. This Christmas at Funky Pigeon, get 50% off 5 cards or more. For every kind of Christmas. FunkyPigeon.com.
Believe it or not, the furry family felines that enrich our lives today really aren't so very different from the African wildcats they're descended from. So the more we know about their wild ancestry, the better equipped we'll be to keep our feline family members happy. You can learn more about your cat's wild side by requesting this free guide, packed with tips on how to recognise and manage natural cat behaviours. So whether you've got a tiny tiger or the king of the jungle, text Guide 5 to 70007 or search Cat Protection Behaviour to get your copy today.
Do you want to stay active but feel the need to slow down? To help maintain an active lifestyle, try 7C's Joint Care Supplex and Turmeric. One convenient duo pack combines 7C's highest turmeric levels, plus glucosamine and omega-3. It also contains vitamin C for cartilage, vitamin D for bones and normal muscle function, and manganese for connective tissue. To help maintain an active lifestyle, try 7C's Joint Care Supplex and Turmeric today. This has been Medifax for 7C's.
Times are tight, and right now, things can feel a little constrained, like there isn't much wiggle room. Sure, you can get a new phone if you want, but is that always right for you?
With EE, you can get an annual checkup on your current device designed to keep your phone in tip-top condition. Count on EE, the UK's best network.
I'm Adrian Dunbar, and I want to take you to some of my favourite places in Ireland, from magical landscapes to my beautiful hometown.
Wow, that's impressive, isn't it?
And sampling the best Ireland has to offer.
That's a beautiful dish.
Thank you.
Adrian Dunbar, My Ireland. Watch now on My5.
It's the summer of 1986, and Queen are back on tour, back on stage, and back on top. They embark on the biggest tour of their lives, the Magic Tour, to plug their smash hit album, A Kind of Magic. Wembley Stadium, scene of their triumphant Live Aid set, hosts two of the 26 dates across Europe, with a total of 1 million fans rocking out to Queen live.
The Magic Tour was the last tour Queen ever did, so talk about going out on a high. Fantastic footage of Wembley Stadium, 80,000, just like Live Aid, really looks like it could be the same crowd.
Everybody remembers Freddie and his white joggers and his white singlet, and then he has this bright yellow bolero jacket, and he is this matador. You know, his movements are so crisp and sharp and very much like a bullfighter.
The finale of the show was always the pièce de résistance. Brian strikes up the chords of God Save the Queen on the guitar.
Freddie would stroll out with his long ermine-trimmed cape, holding aloft the crown, because, of course, he is the ultimate queen, and the audience just loses their collective marbles.
It's shamelessly imperialist, if you think about it, but it got away with it. It was funny, it was serious, it was respectful, it was a tearjerker. It never failed to move everybody. He knew what he was doing.
Thank you. Good night.
The band even made the controversial decision to take the show behind enemy lines.
During the Cold War, Eastern Europe was pretty much off limits to rock music. I mean, the kids there were desperate for it, but it was seen as a disruptive influence and an embodiment of the decadence of the West.
The Hungarians are record mad, but Queen are aiming to break into the whole Eastern Bloc market of 300 million potential record buyers.
These countries are building up nuclear arsenals, the Berlin Wall's still standing, and suddenly you've got this flamboyant rock band going and playing behind the Iron Curtain.
It's like unconquered territory.
You have a very extrovert stage act by any standards. Will you be able to go on with...
You mean affluenting?
You're over the top.
enough.
I remember in Hungary, there were people who bought tickets. They'd spent a month's wages. They would walk 30 miles to get to the Népstadion for that show.
As the crowd awaited Queen's arrival, there were the usual warm-up band.
The audience were in heaven in a culture that doesn't even have rock and roll, number one. And number two, it doesn't have huge, huge acts that can fill a football stadium.
And this intimate duet with just Brian on guitar and Freddie on vocals, live from Budapest, demonstrates how Freddie would personalize this show for a Hungarian audience.
This is a very special song from Queen to you.
He learned this beautiful Hungarian folk song. Well, he kind of learned it, but he couldn't remember the words. So he wrote them on the palm of his hand in black felt-tip pen. But they loved it. They absolutely loved the gesture.
Thank you. The Magic Tour was named after the A Kind of Magic album and the lead single from that album.
Is this a kind of magic?
It's sort of a cross between a Disney anthem and a hymn. One of the characteristics of Queen songs is that they're often written as a duet with the audience. So there's always a part for Freddie, which, you know, like he's setting the stage, and with A Kind of Magic, he's doing this kind of gospel build.
It's what they did on Radio Gaga. It's what they did on We Will Rock You. It builds and it builds and it builds. It gets to the chorus, then it drops down so that you can sing. It's a very, very good trick of theirs. On many of their songs, the vocal pyrotechnics don't happen on the parts that the audience are meant to sing. They don't happen on the choruses. They happen on the bits leading up to the choruses, and then the choruses are really user-friendly.
This commercially appealing single and its accompanying video helped stoke an unprecedented demand for Magic Tour tickets.
I mean, they had two Wembley stadiums and they sold out within minutes.
Because the demand was so great, they ended up booking Nebworth.
This footage shows the unfathomable scale of the audience at the Nebworth Park gig.
Officially 120,000 people, unofficially 200,000 people. The biggest live concert ever in the UK, with Queen at their imperious best. Playing everything, playing the ballads, playing the anthems, playing the quirky songs.
I remember it was the biggest number of people I've ever seen at a concert. Huge atmosphere, huge sense of expectation. But for me, at the time, having been to the Wembley show a couple of months earlier, Nebworth wasn't as good.
The band had now got so big that they even needed to arrive at the venue by helicopter.
The band plus all the crew would be about 50 people, and you knew each other. But when you get to stadiums, it's just not possible.
I think a lot of the closeness had gone.
There's tensions. Everybody's getting older. Everybody's got different ideas, different things going on in their lives.
John Deacon was fed up. So this has only come out in recent years that John Deacon was like, I'm going to quit, or I need a break. There's one sort of bit of footage of him throwing his bass guitar into the wings of the stage in the middle of a live performance.
John was a big family man, and I think he missed them.
Not only that, but Freddie was also struggling.
We only know certain things with hindsight, don't we? But Freddie was ill by this time, and rising to the occasion was becoming increasingly difficult for him.
He didn't recover like he used to recover. He used to be able to bounce back. That just wasn't possible anymore. And I think at the back of his mind, the thought was there.
By By this point, several of Freddie's close friends had become ill and died from a previously unheard of disease.
The disease, which is almost always fatal, leads to a complete breakdown of the body's own natural defences.
A pandemic was sweeping the globe and disproportionately affecting gay men.
Homosexuals have long since marched in New York on Gay Pride Day, but this year, behind the pride was fear.
I came back from New York, having discovered the new disease, which did not yet have a name, but people were dying without knowing why.
You had a lot of young people who've been going to the bars and having, you know, relationships. They lost their loved ones because nobody knew how serious this was and how it was traveling.
Now we know about HIV, now we know about AIDS, now you know about the effects of it. But at the time, there was just so much misinformation about. People didn't know in the medical profession. By the time it got down to the public, there was even more prejudice and misinformation.
What they called at the time, shamefully, the gay plague. It wasn't a plague, and it didn't only hit gay people. But that's the way the world was at the time. The world was terrified of this new disease that they knew nothing about.
Having scary articles saying, if a gay man is a school teacher, then your children might get AIDS. I mean, that's the level of discussion that there was.
So although we don't know for certain when Freddie Mercury discovered that he was ill, he chose not to make that public. I think he was worried about the idea that if people found out that the lead singer of Queen had AIDS or had HIV, whatever it was at the time, that it would have issues for the other members of Queen and their families.
With Freddie ill and relationships fraught, the end of the Magic Tour signalled another break for the band.
They all did solo things. Brian May went and recorded with Anita Dobson. Roger Taylor began his solo band, The Cross. And Freddie Mercury did a lot of his wonderful work with Montserrat Caballé during that time.
So Freddie harboured a secret love of opera, which actually makes sense given how operatic Queen are. And he went to the opera one night and he saw Montserrat Caballé, and it was love.
She was the supreme soprano of her generation, called La Superba, because Montserrat Caballé was considered to be absolutely superb.
And from the moment she started singing, Freddie's jaw just sort of fell open.
And he was desperate to work with her, but nervous that his voice wouldn't be good enough, that his own training, which was non-existent compared to hers, you know, how would he ever match up to her brilliance?
Freddie opens the song, low in his vocal range, with Montserrat echoing his phrases in her higher soprano register. Here he is performing side by side with his newfound hero in the video for Barcelona, shot in Ibiza.
The video of Barcelona is just fantastic. The bells are ringing out.
And when they sing together, she's not belting like you think of operatic sopranos. You imagine them, if you don't know about opera, like just whacking it out. He's not belting it. He's, wish my dreams, wish my dreams.
She is just, you know, doing this melodic control thing, and then he's kind of punctuating it with power and his masculinity.
They're actually complimenting one another rather than just saying, you stay in your field, I'll stay in mine. They clearly absolutely love working together.
And he's delicately orchestrating this thing that he knows he'll never get to do again and he's probably wanted to do his whole life. And I think it's beautiful.
This photo was taken in Ibiza in 1988 after a two-year hiatus from Queen, when it was becoming difficult for Freddie to hide his condition from the other band members.
He was slowing down. He was looking different.
It was not being talked about much among them, but they knew.
They set aside their differences to mastermind their 13th studio album, The Miracle.
They were friends, they loved each other, and they closed the studio door and they got on and made this beautiful music that had so much energy in it.
Beginning with the whole band in vocal harmony, I Want It All was the first single to emerge from the Miracle album sessions, adorned with the unmistakable, intricate guitar work of its writer, Brian May.
The I Want It All music video delivers this message loud and clear that Queen are the masters of the stadium anthem.
It starts with the harmonies. I want it all. The big anthemic chant along. It's going to have Freddie, you know that. It's going to have the Brian May solo, you know that. You already know the formula. And yet you fall for the trick each time because they do it so brilliantly.
One side note is that you see Freddie for the first time ever not clean shaven. And we learned later that that was because he had marks from Kaposi's sarcoma because he was suffering from HIV. So he sought to cover that up. But his performance is still very powerful.
The greatest sadness of this is, of course, that they never did get to play in a stadium.
As we came to find out, his condition was weakening and leading towards the biggest tragedy in rock music.
This Black Friday, let's split the bill. That means super fast BT broadband for only $14.49 a month for 6 months, with no upfront costs. Pay half the price for half a year on a 24-month contract. Plus, it comes with a £20 money-back speed guarantee. Offers like this only come once in a blue moon or a Black Friday. Hurry, offer ends 8th of December.
Lefroig.
Hello.
I think I love you.
For Daisy at number 12, because she sparkles like a disco. For the neighbours on the left, for all the balls that go over.
This Christmas at Funky Pigeon, order before 9:30 p.m. to get next day delivery on selected cards and gifts. FunkyPigeon.com.
Just for Christmas, our master chocolatiers have lovingly created with our finest Lindt chocolate three heartwarming festive figures, like our adorable chocolate teddy with his unique and magical heart charm. Full of love and warmth, perfect for showing you care. Bring the magic home this Christmas with Lindt.
Just you again this year, dear?
Yeah.
Oh, hello, mate.
How are you?
I'm fine.
Yeah? In this jumper, you can't be fine. How are you really?
This Christmas, let's talk more, because it's good to share, just not your crisps. Walkers has given Comic Relief £2 million to support mental wellbeing programmes.
I love Montana, but I'm doing this for our family.
They will fight you dirty.
Is there any other way?
I do this for my father. I don't do this for me.
We give everything to this land, and I do mean everything.
Brand new Yellowstone on Paramount Plus.
+1989, and in this behind-the-scenes footage, Queen are masterfully producing the song Headlong, part of their 14th and final studio album, Innuendo. Seen here, the up-tempo Headlong and this equally energetic video performance masks Freddie's actual health at this moment.
There is actually some video you can see of Freddie, I think it was late 89, where you can see the visible difference.
He was withdrawing from live performances. He told people he was tired or he didn't want to be a rock star in his 40s. There was a sense that that added to the feeling that something was not right.
And he just felt it was the right time to tell the band.
The irony of this being a band that the lead singer is physically ailing, and you can actually hear more energy in that than you had in all their music throughout the 80s.
Their winning of a Brit Award in 1990 for outstanding contribution prompted this public appearance, in spite of Freddie having withdrawn from actual live performance and touring at this stage.
I remember being at the 1990 Brit Awards and Queen came along to receive an award.
And that was a shock to everybody. It must have been.
All the band appeared live on stage to receive. The unusual thing about that, Freddie didn't speak. He didn't come up to the microphone.
He looked far too thin for the suit he was wearing at the time. And you could see how hollow-cheeked he was.
It was such a moment for them in their careers. And they'd worked so hard to achieve it. But they're all miserable. It's hard for them to be there, you can tell.
Thank you. Good night.
You just thought, oh my goodness. Wow. And then when These Are the Days of Our Lives came out and the video came out, I found it such a hard watch.
Queen's final music video, recorded 6 months before Freddie died. It makes no attempt to hide his deteriorating health, and as such represents an honest, but also heartbreaking, goodbye.
These Are the Days of Our Lives, immensely moving song written by Roger. And Freddie had said to the rest of the band, well, we know what we're dealing with, but I want to work until I drop. I'm not giving up.
You can see that his life force comes from performing. And when you watch him in this video, it's almost painful to see him.
He was finding it very painful just having the clothes on him. Just being there was exhausting. But he insisted on wanting to do this.
He required constant touching up of his makeup, which was just basically crumbling and flaking off his face.
I don't really want to mention it because it's not emotional enough, but the cat's waistcoat is just incredible. It's so amazing.
But then comes that part that breaks everybody's heart, where he looks at the camera and says,
I still love you.
He knows he's saying goodbye.
He was using what little energy he had left to give something for the final time to the people who had made him the star that he was.
He didn't want to be remembered as a poor, pathetic, dwindling performer who'd given in to some disease. That wasn't going to be the memory that he left in our hearts. We deserved a proud Freddie. A Freddie who was still doing what he did best. Sorry.
On the 22nd of November 1991 at 8 p.m, Freddie finally made a public announcement regarding his health status.
I wish to confirm I've been tested HIV positive and have AIDS. The time has now come for my friends and fans around the world to know the truth. I hope everyone will join me, my doctors and all those worldwide in my fight against this terrible disease.
He knew the world had to know before he died, because otherwise it would be like a dirty secret swept under the carpet. And he never, ever wanted that to happen.
On Sunday, the 24th of November, 1991, Freddie died at home.
For the last week of Freddie's life, three of us spent 12 hours a time with Freddie, so he was never actually alone. I know it sounds callous, maybe even, but the first thought was, he's not in pain anymore. Because he'd been in dreadful pain, but he never complained.
I knew there was a chance it could happen, but I was still stunned and so saddened. I lost a very good friend. Very good friend. A kind person. A kind person.
The thing is, I couldn't cry because I still had work to do. I was the one who registered the death. I was the one who arranged the funeral.
Freddie's funeral was on the 27th of November, 1991, at West London Crematorium. There were 5 Daimler hearses for the flowers alone. He had a pale oak coffin, which was carried into Aretha Franklin, a recording of her singing, "You've Got a Friend." And the Verdi aria that was chosen, one of his favorites, was sung by Montserrat Caballé.
This private farewell had none of the Mercury flamboyance. The simple service was over in 25 minutes, and fans respected a family wish to make it a personal affair.
They wanted a private funeral, which was their right, of course it is. But we were cremating the star of the world.
Among the many wreaths was a carnation tribute from Elton John. It read, "A million thanks for my musical pleasure. Hope to see you soon."
I didn't cry until Freddie's coffin disappeared into the crematorium. I still miss him. Of course I do. He was the best friend I had. But he gave amazing music to millions of people who are still listening to the music now.
Aside from family and closer friends, no one was hit harder by the death of Freddie than the remaining members of the band.
Brian May and Roger Taylor did an interview on TVAM shortly after Freddie Mercury's death. They both looked absolutely traumatised, and you could tell there were a lot of emotions running high here.
What will happen to you?
We haven't really decided. We haven't really... I mean, we've been quite knocked over by it, as you can imagine, and we haven't really got over the first stages of grieving, I don't think, yet.
But already they hinted at plans for a way to honour their beloved frontman.
We're thinking of doing something next year, some kind of event, you know, probably in his name, that will be something positive and will raise a lot of money, we hope.
And that event became the Freddie Mercury Tribute Concert.
I was asked to come along and out of retirement and help John. And I think Queen wanted members of the old crew around them, because they were going to be going on stage at Wembley without Fred.
5 months after Freddie's death, Queen were back on the same stage that had been the scene of significant past triumphs, seen here opening the show, which would feature some of the greatest musical acts of the time.
Now we're going to join the remaining members of Queen.
The Freddie Mercury tribute concert was another one of those most memorable events that anyone who attended ever was at. They didn't know who was next. Superstar after superstar came out.
Biggest names in rock and roll: Bowie, Robert Plant, Roger Daltrey, Elton John.
Who's the right artist for this song?
This song is one of my favourites. It's called Somebody to Love.
George Michael, I think he took it to a level that was Freddie-esque. He chose Somebody to Love, which was probably one of Freddie's best songs.
This is regarded by many as one of the standout performances of the concert, with George Michael most definitely channeling the spirit of Freddie in both his vocal and stage performance.
The timbre of his voice is actually somewhat similar to Freddie's. And then also, I think just the sentiment of the song. It's wanting to be rescued from loneliness. I think this is something that George Michael related to. And so you can see him just...
groups of extremely straight men, all a bit pissed, weeping openly when Freddie Mercury came up on the screen. I remember at the time thinking, wow, there's an outpouring of emotion here, which is quite unlike anything I'd ever seen before.
It was a real triumph of taste. And I give full credit to Queen for having put together this loving moment for their friend.
72,000 tickets sold in a couple of hours. Over a billion people saw it around the world. And the rumoured figure that was raised was somewhere like $35 million for the charity. Whether it was that much, we don't know, but it certainly was a huge success.
Freddie Mercury was 45 when he died. Queen's career has stretched 21 years, and they had sold over 80 million original release albums worldwide. After his death, the whole band may have thought it was all over. Little did they know there was so much more to come.
Just for Christmas, our master chocolatiers have lovingly created with our finest Lindt chocolate three heartwarming festive figures, like our adorable chocolate teddy with his unique and magical heart charm. Full of love and warmth, perfect for showing you care. Bring the magic home this Christmas with Lindt.
Just you again this year, dear?
Yeah.
Oh, hello, mate.
How are you?
I'm fine.
Yeah? In this jumper, you can't be fine. How are you really?
This Christmas, let's talk more, because it's good to share, just not your crisps. Walkers has given Comic Relief £2 million to support mental wellbeing programmes.
Want perfectly shaped stubble without needing to go to the barbers?
Use the King C. Gillette Stylemaster, because without it, something's bound to go wrong.
Stylemaster, the 3-in-1 tool that trims, shaves, and edges to perfection.
Style like a king.
Now, with 50% off. This Black Friday, let's split the bill. That means super fast BT broadband for only $14.49 a month for 6 months. With no upfront costs. Pay half the price for half a year on a 24-month contract. Plus, it comes with a £20 money-back speed guarantee. Offers like this only come once in a blue moon or a Black Friday. Hurry, offer ends 8th of December.
Lefroig.
Hello.
I think I love you.
Welcome to Pluto TV, a free streaming service. Over 150 live channels, from crime to movies
Action.
To reality and a whole lot more.
Here I am.
No sign up, so you can dive right in.
Yes, babes.
Drop in. It's free. Pluto TV.
May 1992, nearly 6 months after Freddie died, and once again, Queen had conquered Wembley at the Freddie Mercury tribute concert.
I met with them some weeks afterwards, and they actually said to me, that's it, Queen is over, Queen is over. John Deacon said, I won't perform again.
But for the remaining two band members, it was a different story.
I think for Brian and Roger, once they'd got over the shock of losing Freddie, there was no question that they would carry on performing, recording, being Queen. It was a question then of how do you keep the legacy alive?
A recent poll found it to be the top rock anthem of all time. Now the West End musical it spawned is celebrating its second year of packing in the punters.
On the 14th of May 2002, a Queen musical, We Will Rock You, opened in London's West End.
We Will Rock You was a Queen jukebox musical, pretty much, written by Ben Elton. It was set 300 years in the future. expression is banned, music is banned, and then the denizens of the world come across an electric guitar.
Basically, the storyline gave them the opportunity to shoehorn in loads of great Queen hits.
I could see why We Will Rock You was a success. It was all about the songs. Personally, I think Freddie would have hated the story. I think Bedard's script was appalling.
However, audiences begged to differ and showed up in their droves.
By 2005, it was playing in Moscow, Melbourne, and it had become the longest-running musical at London's Dominion Theatre.
Flying high from the staggering success of the musical, the next logical step for Brian and Roger was Hollywood.
The idea was, let's make a dramatic film about the life of Queen.
It was in the making for quite a long time, I think 13 or 14 years. It went through all kinds of difficulties. There were various actors tipped to play Freddie, who never actually did get to play Freddie.
Sacha Baron Cohen was in the mix originally. The story Sacha Baron Cohen wanted to convey was far more hedonistic than the ones that the film company wanted to portray.
But of course, it was good they waited because they found Malik and he was so good.
I worked with Rami to make sure that Freddie was as Freddie as possible. You know, that the hand movements were there, that the way he moved was there, all of those sort of things. It was an incredible, incredible experience.
Finally, 8 years after its official announcement, Bohemian Rhapsody was released in 2018 and blew box office records.
It took over $900 million in the box office. It's practically a superhero movie in terms of its box office profits.
The highest grossing musical biopic ever. How could you argue with that?
But argue people did. Fitting to the career of Queen, not everyone was happy with the end product.
The story was condensed. They did take a few wrong turns. They led us to believe a few things which I knew not to be the case.
Freddie told the band in the film before Live Aid he had AIDS. He told the band 4 years after Live Aid.
And some critics claimed that the salaciousness of Freddie's lifestyle had been watered down.
They wanted it to be a Freddie Mercury film and not a Queen. All that stuff is in there. I don't know how much more you want.
It's all there. I mean, Freddie's life going round to the bars in New York is all there. There's no question of how he was behaving. But I know some people in show business thought it could have gone further.
At the end of the day, it's a drama. Not documentary, it's not passing it all off as fact.
But they make the most amazing film that won 4 Oscars.
We hoped it would do well, but the way it's touched people's hearts has been amazing to see.
There was delicious symmetry in the fact that the critics panned We Will Rock You and Bohemian Rhapsody, the film, but the fans loved it. And it brought their experience full circle.
The story of Queen began 50 years past and is one that continues today. They're a machine forged in Britain, fine-tuned in sheds and music halls, who then conquered the world. The power and the pomp, glory and drama, from best friends to bust-ups. Going against the grain is what they did to create Britain's favourite hits. Theirs is a song that rings out from the theatres to the sports terraces, from the opera houses to the football grounds, to the greatest audiences the world did ever see.
Queen hold a really special place in British culture because they are all things to all people. They defy generations. They have stood the test of time.
With everything that they've done, they've always offered an alternate reality. They pick you up and they transport you somewhere else.
That love of singing, of performance, of song, it permeates every single Queen performance. You may love some, you may hate others, but what nobody can deny is the passion and the heart and soul and the commitment and the authenticity of Queen's music.
They believed in us. and we believed in them. And just as Freddie is singing here, not only to his fans at Wembley, but to those all over the world, Queen will remain our champions forever.